Hello and welcome to eColleagues. A very good evening to all of you. Today we'll understand and we'll discuss the topic of FCI reforms. Now the reforms in Food Corporation of India, and we will discuss about the subsidy that Government of India gives to these stockholding, as well as we will also discuss apart from this subsidies, and we will also discuss about the impact of these subsidy on fiscal deficit, because you know that government cut the corporate income tax and 1.45 lakh crore is the loss that government has to incur in order to cut these taxes. So in this lecture we will understand Government of India's expenditure policy, especially regarding these subsidies, because this is what we can cut in the near term in order to maintain the fiscal deficit target. So let's begin with the discussion, very important discussion, especially for UPSC aspirants. General Studies Paper 3, as General Studies Paper 3, economy means more or less agriculture sector, and the Indian Economic Service Examination, where in Indian economy, that is the paper number 4 of economics, and in overall paper number 6. So these are vital topic. Let me start that the central government or the government is struggling with the unpaid and lot of ballooning subsidy. It means high amount of subsidies, especially the question is all about the funding. So how we will arrange the funding of these unpaid subsidies? Now if we calculate this, there is always a question of maintenance of fiscal deficit. The target, the comfortable target, is 3% of the GDP, but this year government estimated at 3.3%, but with the corporate income tax and other expenditure by the Government of India, it is expected that government may breach this limit and may able to reach 3.8%. Now if we start a discussion from, we can say, 2001 and 2002 period, the percentage of subsidy that was released in this particular year exceeded 74% of the total. Apart from this, all the years it remained like this except for the year 2011-12. Now if we see that things have changed after 2013, September 2013, especially what happened in September 2013, that was National Food Security Act. National Food Security Act was enacted or was introduced, but the full impact of this National Food Security Act felt around 2014-15. So we can say that the growth, that is the growth of the government subsidy, went up to around, we can say, 10% at that particular point. Here we can say the gap between the subsidy burden, gap between the subsidy burden of FCI and the amount that Government of India has to pay in order to reimburse the Food Corporation of India in 2014-15, that was actually increasing a lot. It means FCI is incurring the cost, but government is not reimbursing. So that's the question. It means FCI is incurring the cost of procuring the food grains, but Government of India is not compensating Food Corporation of India. Now here we can say that if you can see that National Food Security Act that guarantees 5 kg of food grains, that is per person, food grains per person per month. So under National Food Security Act, every person is entitled to get 5 kg food grains, that is per person per month. And if that individual belonging to Antyodaya Anna Yojana, so if the person belongs to Antyodaya Anna Yojana household, that guarantees 35 kg. Per household per month. Now here we can say the National Food Security Act mandates to cover 67% of the population. It means almost 2/3. And among that, 75% should be from rural area and 50% from the urban areas. So that is the rule. But they must highly receive the highly subsidized food grains. And the allocation of food grains is very unequal. Generally, these food grains released under NFSA, more or less we have wheat and rice. So the government focus on two things. If you see the report of PRS India, the expenditure on food security, is increasing. While we can say the people belonging to BPL category, that is the BPL line, the people below the BPL line is falling. So you can see that the ratio was 21.9% and the number of poor is 26.9 crore. Now here we can say a similar trend can also be measured in terms of the nourishment or undernourished person in India. Here we can say undernourished people in India has been declining from 24% in 1990 to 15% in 2014 according to PRS India report. Now here we can say that there are two important questions. Now this government, that is NDA second, NDA 2, that has inherited the scheme of National Food Security Act. So what kind of reforms we can undertake in this National Food Security Act? The number one thing that we can do is that the prices of the rice at rupees 3, the prices of wheat at rupees 2, and the prices of coarse grains again stands at rupee 1. While we can say, if you see, these prices were fixed in the year 2013, but they have remained intact. But we can say, on the other hand, the cost of procurement as well as the storage cost, so cost of procurement and storage cost have increased. Now here, if the prices were regularly increased, obviously the subsidy bill of Food Corporation of India will obviously increase in the near future as well. The second important point we need to put a stress on is the number of beneficiaries. So according to PIB report in July 2019, 81.3 crore people or beneficiaries are getting benefit under NFSA. As we can say, in the original NFSA, that was approximately the estimated at the 35 crore. So we can say that the obviously the number of people increased under NFSA. Before NFSA, it was 35 crore. Now it is 81 crore, so almost double. Now another, the third important factor here is we have the open-ended purchase. So open-ended purchase of the Food Corporation of India has led to excess of the food grains, excess of the grains stock in their godown that is held by the Food Corporation of India. Open procurement policy means any farmer can go to FCI and they can sell their produce. Now if you see these kind of stock, that according to FCI, if you see FCI stock holding, that is we can say for wheat, they are having around 41 million tons, as their limit to maintain the buffer stock is only 20 million tons. If you see the rice, they are maintaining 26 million tons of food grains in their godowns, where the limit, the buffer stock limit is, or the stocking norms is, allow only 10 million tons. Although we can say stock norms last revised in the year 2015. So we need certain reforms here as well. We need to revise this stocking policy. Next point we have, that if you see that there is a decline in the poverty rate. Now, if you have the decline in the poverty rate, we can say, but still there are people, there are non-poor included in this poverty line. So they are getting the benefit. That is what we call the inclusion error. It means including those people who are actually not poor. The next point we have, that if you see the leakages in the public distribution system, according to famous economist Ashok Gulati, agricultural economist Ashok Gulati, according to Ashok Gulati report, they have witnessed that around 46.7% there are leakages in 2011 report. So 46.7%, that is the leakages of whatever the produce going through the process of public distribution system. Although this government, NDA government, has done well in introducing the POS machines, that is what we call mini ATM, the point over sale machines, that swipe machine, you can understand, that actually helped in removing the fake beneficiaries of PDS. But leakages continues, and it is estimated to 30 to 40% that government is bearing all the leakages. Now, leakages can be reduced if the issue price, what's our central government actually give, what issue price, that is that must be linked with 50 to 75% of the MSP. So if we link with this, obviously these kind of leakages will also come down. Now the question again arises, that FCI is procuring food grains, but the government of India is not compensating FCI. That is why the unpaid food subsidy is making news these days. Now if you see what government is doing right now, or what government has done in the 2016-17. Now you have the fund, lot of fund at the government expense, we can say. The number one is National Saving Schemes. So under the National Saving Schemes, government borrowed money. So people purchasing the National Saving Certificates, etc., they purchase for 5 years. It means that is a long term. So government borrowed for the short term in order to meet the FCI liabilities. What happened, that if you see, the borrowing started in the year 2016-17, when the central government is struggling to pay out the FCI, as well as we can say the other commitment like 7th pay commission. If you see the annual outflow at that particular time for the 7th pay commission, approximately 1.02 lakh crore. So this is quite high. As we can say, the about the food as well as salary payout increase, so we can say the increase in the government from the National Saving Schemes. Despite, we can say, central government spent around rupees 4 lakh crore, excluding the state government spent and the crisis of farmer disaster, distress, etc., we can say still government is struggling with the shortage of the funds. Cause for the distress of another year. Now if you see that agriculture is the state subject, it means state government has having their prerogative in order to make laws for the agriculture. So we generally forget that agriculture is a state subject, and this is done by the Government of India Act 1935. So a colonial legacy. But we generally expect that center should reduce the farm distress. Now this farm distress is very important. Like I've been teaching for many years in this field, again and again I'm saying that there will be a day where agriculture crisis will be bursted like a big balloon. So what we have to do here, we need certain quick reforms, otherwise there's a problem of the food grain availability in India. Now suppose we can say, instead of we are scrapping APMC Act, what is APMC? That is Agriculture Produce Marketing Act. We introduce laws for contract farming. So contract farming, as well as we can say agriculture land lease, and we can say we should promote drip irrigation. Others like what state government is doing? State government doing, they are writing off the farmers' loans. So writing off loans means the loan waiver. It means in the balance sheet, they are writing as their loss. Apart from this, what state government is doing? State government providing free power or subsidized power, free water or subsidized water. And states are not even agreed to abolish the taxes like the mandi tax. So if you see the mandi tax rate, which is as high as 6% in Punjab, and we can say 4% in Haryana and 0.2% in Madhya Pradesh. So these are very, very high. If you see for pulses, the mandi tax also imposed in UP, MP, Gujarat, etc. So we can say these kind of subsidy that state government is giving by giving free power, free electricity, they are creating the vicious circle. That vicious circle is very vital and it will hurt in the long run. Now this vicious circle of distress will continue to haunt the Indian farmers and will leave the state government with no or less resources. Now for example, if we say that the lesser resources for, we can say, the agriculture capital investment for research and development. In the previous live session that we have seen that research and development plays an important role, especially in the agriculture sector. Now we have a good challenge, a very challenging situation about the water management in near future. Like if see the Tamil Nadu and Karnataka farmers, they are struggling. See water management. This year we got the decent or more than decent amount of monsoon. But what will happen in the next few years? The situation of the climate change and etc. So we require certain kind of resources for to include these kind of activities which will gain in the long term. Now if you see the responsibility of the state government, these kind of responsibility that a state government should take. So only few state government are actually thinking in this direction. Now if you see that center must launch a communication campaign with these objective with the states. Like this is the vertical communication, center to the states. But the horizontal communication is among the states. So center should have the responsibility to communicate to all the states about the benefits of these kind of activities in the long run. Now the number one point that we require to change is the change in the mindset. Change in the mindset, like from food deficiency to food surplus nation. We have enough amount of food, but it's all about the management of that available food grains. The second thing is we need to educate people. So we need to educate people, especially the center and the state government, which are responsible for their accountability. The third important thing here is we need to aware people about the benefits of consuming other food grains like millets. If you see the production of millets during the Green Revolution, that is around the 1966, it was 37 million hectares. That was the area. Now if you see area under the millets, especially in the current period, so 2015-16, that is 14.7 million hectare. So the area under millets have been declining. Why? Because the MSP announced generally for wheat and rice and other major crops, and we are ignoring the other crops. So that's a big question in front of the policymakers. So these are the three important things that we need to take into consideration. The fourth important point here, we see that if you see 1965, this is the year where Food Corporation of India was set up. But here in 2014, Modi government announced one committee known as Shanta Kumar Committee, very important committee, Shanta Kumar Committee. And this committee took a research and gave its report in 2015 about making the entire food grain management system more efficient, as well as they suggested the orientation or reorienting the role of Food Corporation of India, the MSP procurement, storage, distribution of gains, and TPDS, that is Targeted Public Delivery System. So we'll see that this report, what this report tell us about. So we'll see the Shanta Kumar Committee report. This report is very important in the recent years as well. Number one suggestion, what Shanta Kumar Committee suggested, that Food Corporation of India should hand over all the procurement operations, especially for wheat and paddy, and we can say other crops as well, to the states which have gained sufficient experience in actually procuring the food grains, which also have certain reasonable infrastructure as well as the responsibility for procurement. So what Shanta Kumar and committee is saying, that FCI should hand over all the procurements, especially for wheat and rice, to those states like the states of Andhra Pradesh, states of Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, states of Odisha, states of Punjab, like this. Because these states have gained enough experience, especially we can say reasonable and infrastructure that they have created. The second important point under this is that FCI should accept only the surplus grains. So it means if there is not availability or unavailability of the surplus gain, then FCI should not take these kind of food grains. It means after deducting the share of NFSA, then if there is any surplus left, then this FCI, Food Corporation of India, should adopt the procurement policy. As on 2017 December, 17 states have adopted the decentralized procurement policy. What's the meaning of decentralized procurement policy? Suppose this is an area of the state and here we have certain FCI godown. What is the meaning of decentralized procurement scheme or the process is that here we have FCI godown. It means that people are coming to the FCI godown at a one place. So the transportation cost is high. What we have to do, we have to take these food grains from the different places to the different small godowns. So that will actually save the cost of the farmers. The third suggestion, what Shanta Kumar Committee suggested, that whenever we have statutory levies, what is the meaning of statutory levies? It means it's like same as the taxes. So these statutory levies include certain commissions as well. And that commissions varies state to state, like 2% in Gujarat, and we can say West Bengal, but we have as high as 14.5% in Punjab. Now these kind of statutory levies actually discourage farmers. What we need is around 2-3% must be uniform rate, or we can say we can link with the like 4% of MSP. If we will do these kind of things, then it will give the fruitful result for the farmers. The next point is the fourth point, where we can say that Government of India should revisit its MSP policy, that is minimum support price policy. Currently, government announced for 23 crops But generally, we can say government focus only on wheat and rice. It means whenever government focus on wheat and rice, they are ignoring the other, in the importance of other, the food grains or food grain crops. It means suppose in an area like Vidarbha, where it is not suitable for rice, but people were growing rice. Why? Because the rice fetches them more amount of money due to high MSP. So the problem of water shortage, etc. Now if you do this, you will equally announce the MSP for all the 23 crops or equally update them. That will save the water subsidy also. The fifth point we have that reveals that National Food Security Act that gives the coverage to the 67% of the population, which is way much higher for a country like India, and it should reduce to 40%, where we will cover all the BPL category households quite sufficiently. So government should think about in reducing the coverage of the National Food Security Act, and we have to do this by actually excluding the non-poor from the list. The sixth and the last suggestion, the recommendation by the Shantakumar committee, is there must be a transparent liquidation policy. What's the meaning of liquidation policy? It means whenever FCI faced a situation of surplus stock, then the buffer norm which is required, then the FCI should allow to actually release the food grains at a transparent liquidation policy. It means whenever FCI faces surplus in comparison to the limit of the buffer stock, then FCI should allow to actually sell out or excess or give these excess food grains that they are possessing with a transparent liquidation policy. That will give less motivation to the corruption. So at last, I would like to say that the government can use the platform of Pradhan Mantri Kisan Samman Nidhi scheme to get started, or to give the states to boost about the digitization of the land records. The land records very important, because in order to find the exact true beneficiary, we need digitization of land records, farmers' data, etc. Once we have done with this, then the reliability of farmer should allow the government to explore the payment system by direct benefit transfer directly into their account, especially with the support of real-time data. Now, if you see that in India, although this is a fact of all the Indians, in India, or this is the mentality of Indians, whenever we say that we actually very resistant to change, we people don't like changes. What we accept, that they accept change whenever there is a crisis. Like in the recent years, since 2014, government or the industry demand to reducing the corporate income tax. But when government did in 2019, when Indian economy struggling with the slowdown, again the crisis, then government reduced the corporate income tax. Another example, 1991, the economic crisis, then government brought in with LPG reforms. So my question is, are we waiting for the crisis in agriculture in order to implement the reforms? So that's the end of the session. If you have any doubts, suggestion, most welcome with your doubts, you can ask. So this is a session that we meet at daily 10:30 p.m. from Monday to Saturday. So it means we are not meeting tomorrow. Tomorrow is a Sunday, so tomorrow is a holiday for that. So 10:30 p.m. we are meeting from Monday to Saturday regarding the current economic discussion and analysis. And these kind of analysis is very helpful for the UPSC examination, especially Indian Administrative Services and the economics optional student and the Indian Economic Services. These kind of discussion will help you in RBI written examination, the second phase. Apart from this, in all the bank PO examination as well as SO examination, you have to write one essay. That will also give certain points to you. So we'll meet on Monday, 10:30 p.m. Before that, I'll take the doubts. Is digitization is the only way? I cannot say that digitalization is the only way, but digitalization, whenever you will implement, it will bring more efficiency to the system. So it will actually remove the part of corruption or manipulation. So whenever you have digital data, digital system, then you cannot manipulate, or there are less chances to manipulate. That's why digitization will help in actually providing the land reforms as well. Apart from this, from the next month, we are starting our economics optional course and the Indian Economic Service course. That is from 1st December. Economics optional, we are starting from the 15th November. Apart from this, a new course of PG entrance examination for JNU and Delhi University and Delhi School of Economics, that will start from 1st December again. And the UGC NET examination, that the next batch for the 2020 will start from the 15th of December. So if you are interested, you can visit our website ecoholics.in. And on this website, you will find all the information. Apart from this, you can also follow us on Instagram, where we provide daily questions. And you can also connect directly to me on this WhatsApp number given on the screens. So thank you for tuning in and have a happy Sunday. So we'll meet on Monday again at 10:30 p.m. So thank you. Till then, see you soon. Good night.